So in these organizations or networks, I don't really exist as an artist. I could not do any artistic projects about them, or I don't represent them in my works. I'm not trying to say it shouldn't be done, just I'm not doing it. But on the other hand, I'm traveling a lot because of the art, because I'm invited to many places. And using this platform, it gives me the chance to share my experience from my geography, art history, and I think this opens up a space to learn from each other and compare the experiences. So on one hand, I feel lucky, I'm also immersed, I feel lucky to have all this connection, solidarity, and collectivism, but this doesn't mean I'm not questioning it all the time, if it really works, or if we need to invent different forms. So when I move as an artist, I'm also investing in politics, and when I move for political reasons, I'm investing in art, multitasking and putting my eggs in many different baskets. So sometimes I feel like an agent trying to leak into every possible crack and trying to promote ideas or ideology. So yeah, maybe I'm not directly changing anything, but I believe in raising questions through art. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think also something we can take about away from that is the importance of, it's almost pleasure or desire or the emotional within these discussions. And sometimes that's so easily dropped out when we start to regurgitate the kind of political, theoretical discourse. And I think that the work that you're doing and the way we talk here is really important directive to that, to understand that it has, that if we are to get anywhere, it has to appeal on all these different levels and not only the intellectual. And I think that's very important. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Lorenzo Martins, who's an artist based in Amsterdam, but has been working for a number of years now and continues to work on a long-term project in Congo. I hope the film, which is part of the exhibition Joy Poverty, was in a way the first outcome of that engagement. And we're going to hear about the developments that have happened since. Thank you.
Indeed, my name is Renzo. I think the other microphone is better. I would like to talk a little bit about the facility with which artists, and I guess we have many artists here, the facility with which we like to associate with all kinds of political struggles, the facility with which we think is that we are the problem agents or facilitators of underrepresented groups or political struggles. I think so often the facility with which we do this obscures much more than it reveals. And to try and make my point, I'll first show you a tiny interaction I had a few years ago with a plantation worker in Congo. His name is Mibale. Maybe we can watch the first film. This is a few minutes. Mibale works on a Unilever plantation in Congo.
Bon, j'ai dit que si moi, il n'y a pas de salaire pour toucher, c'est moi qui n'arrive.
Tu gagnes combien?
Bon,
tu gagnes combien?
Thank you.
And our conference in the state will in
one way or the other be paid by Unilever and by the Cocoa Board through taxes, through private sponsorship, through what have you. I'm not saying sponsors have to be paid by them, but now they are. In the way they look and most of the institutions function, they are. So I think it's not enough to proclaim our innocence by decolonizing the discourse, by not using certain words anymore and replacing them with other words. It's not enough. And it's sickening to me that we think all the time that it is enough, and that we invest so much time in thinking that it is enough. It is of a, yesterday, yeah, some kind of protective shadowness, I believe. And the more that we seem to deal with these issues, the more colonial we become. I think the more African artists are invited to the Venice Biennial, which in itself is very good and very important, the more the Venice Biennial becomes a colonial institution. Not because it was set up 100 years ago as a nation state kind of endeavor, but right now. Because in the end, the capital accumulates around these centers of reception. All over the world, we can pick up terrible things that we need to critique. We do that on forums, like, for example, this fictional talk on, or this fictional conference on decolonizing institutions that certainly will take place in Amsterdam if it hasn't already taken place. That's where the intellectual, artistic, emotional, spiritual, and of course also financial capital is going to accumulate, not on the plantation. So what I really like to propose is that we do have to do something more real, and it demands a material critique of this post-colonial discourse. Who actually benefits from it? It needs self-analysis. And so in that framework, I thought it was very necessary to create a hub for this critical art machine that we are part of, not in Venice, not even in Jakarta, but on a global production. And I did it after spending a lot of time in Congo, 10 years or 11 years, so making all kinds of acquaintances and friends. And together with the Congolese plantation workers, RD, we set up this quote-unquote gentrification program on the Unilever plantation in the Congolese forest. And our opening seminar took place in 2012. And again, within the framework of this, in my mind, necessary self-analysis, we invited Richard Florida to be the keynote speaker. Now, I understand and I agree that we all disagree with Richard Florida and his take on what art's function in the world is. You know, for Florida, art is just one vehicle for economic growth. It's not a space for dissent, it's not a space for any political articulation, it's just a space for capital accumulation. And yet, how can we afford to, and we, I speak mostly here to people who are part of the globalized art world, which spreads from Singapore to Los Angeles, with stops in Dubai, and the Korea, etc. How can we afford to use Florida's archives all the time? Because that's why biennials and museums, as I've been pointed out this morning several times, that's how biennials and institutions receive their funding. That's how we probably receive the funding in one way or the other to take a plane and fly to Jakarta. How can we afford to use that knowledge for ourselves, for the importance of our discourses, and yet deny it to Libai? He wants to make. He's certainly capable of creating both emotional and critical renditions of his own conditions. I don't think I'm the only one who can do it. He's probably has certainly a lot more experience. Within, again, the framework of the neoliberal economy that we inhabit, how can I afford to not offer that knowledge to him? because it's morally not correct to do, right? Or because I disagree with Florida's take on what art is. And yet I allow myself to live on it and will not. So anyway, Florida was there. So maybe we should speak at the, look at the second little bit.
Showing how poor people are in Congo, for example, but what happens is that video is then maybe shown in New York or in London and generating the economy in London rather than in Congo. So this is something we would like to try and reverse. So we call it a reverse gentrification. That would be maybe a better way of putting it. Would you have any comments on that?
I think it's a very interesting intellectual, conceptual, and pragmatic issues that you've raised. And so I think those contradictions that you mentioned are part of the development of what capitalism has created. And I think it's incumbent upon us, artists and creative people, to lead in those struggles. And not simply, and I'm saying this with all humility, complain. And in the Congo, what you're doing, you have the opportunity to show that in a place that isn't the wealthiest place on the planet, in a place that has struggled, you can put it in places you can talk.
Yeah. Well, thanks a lot, Richard. I think it's what we're trying to do. Of course, there's more to it, but it's really fantastic that you give us this advice. And I think you also, we're kind of at the end of the scheduled talk, and I know you have many other talks to do. So we'll kind of stop here, I believe. Thanks again.
Yes. And keep us posted by how you're doing.
So when Florida speaks about artistic production comes before roads and hospitals and all that, I'm sure I disagree. And yet, this is kind of what we tell our funders all the time. So again, merely building a research center, as we are doing, on the relationship between art and global inequality on the plantation, not that one we were chased away by the company that does the production for Unilever, and they confiscated all the drawings and everything, so we relocated to another former Unilever plantation. However much I disagree with you, Florida, it seems to be completely immoral to allow ourselves again to be funded by these strategies of his. All big cities that have these ideas, they listen to Florida, they invite him again, that's why they fund us. So it's just up to us within the moment that we are inhabiting to take ownership over that. If gentrification is the main goal of political art for the people that fund it, then we need to take ownership over it. And we need to make sure that it happens there and how and in what way that is relevant and real and truthful. So this reverse gentrification program is on the one hand a form of institutional critique of the existing art world schemes that we inhabit, and on the other hand, of course, it's an attempt to really change it and do it very, very differently. And I'm happy to say that, again, by establishing this institute and its focus on the relationship between art and global inequality, we've done a number of show and events and conferences, and indeed capital does accumulate now. All of it has seven attracts research grants, and it attracts sharp and edgy anthropologists, and it attracts all the people from around the plantation that want to change everything. That's all.
Thanks a lot, Renzo. There's a lot to talk about, and I hope we can discuss Renzo's presentation in a minute as well. But thank you very much for that. Now we go to the third speaker, who's from Depok, Asun, Reza Asun Argentina. They will talk, I think, about Brian Rupert, who is he's part of the Brian Rupert Collective, about Brian Rupert's reverse colonization, if you like, and we talk about reverse gentrification, and we have reverse colonization. And it's a little bit cynical, that, but maybe also has some truth in it. being the artistic directors as a group of the forthcoming Salzbeek exhibition in the Netherlands, in Ireland, which is an exhibition that goes back to the 1950s. And it's intimately happened in the city, in the public space of a small Dutch town called Arnhem.
Thank you very much. Actually, firstly, I apologize because I would like to speak in Bahasa if it's necessary. So, because there's like some of the, what's it called? Like the, because some of the things that I would like to talk about, sometimes I derive, it derives from Bahasa, even though it could be translated particularly English, but I cannot do very well in English. So I tried Bahasa, so hopefully our friends, the interpreters could help me out regarding this matter. Thank you very much. Sebelumnya terima kasih untuk waktu, perhatian, dan kerjasamanya. Dalam kaitan Jakarta Biennale 2015 kali ini, saya Reza Afisina. Saya lahir di Bandung, Jawa Barat. Akan tetapi kemudian saya pindah ke Jakarta sekitar tahun 1995. Kemudian saya tinggal di Jakarta beberapa tahun. Dan kemudian saya sekarang pindah kota di provinsi yang lain, itu di Depok, yang berbatasan sangat dekat dengan kota Jakarta. Jadi tadi terima kasih Taos untuk memperkenalkan saya sebagai salah satu partisipan dari Depok, karena terkadang kota ini sedikit dilupakan, walaupun itu sebetulnya sudah menjadi kota, walaupun masih terlalu muda untuk disebut kota, tapi sudah sekitar 13 tahun. Lalu dalam kaitannya presentasi kali ini dalam sebuah simposium, saya akan mewakili satu tentang ruang rupa, selaku organisasi dan juga selaku seniman kolektif yang berasal dari Jakarta, dan yang kedua mungkin sedikitnya bagaimana saya bisa terlibat, dan karena saya sendiri adalah seorang seniman, jadi itu akan ada singgungannya dengan praktek seni rupa atau peningkatan artistik seni rupa saya yang juga saling berkontribusi satu sama lain dengan pekerjaan saya di ruang rupa. Jadi ruang rupa itu secara garis besar dia hadir sekitar tahun 2000, di mana itu adalah 2 tahun setelah runtuhnya Orde Baru. Dalam artian saya bagian dari student movement kala itu, dan tapi itu adalah bukan merupakan satu tindakan yang heroik kalau menurut saya secara pribadi. Itu adalah satu kesempatan bagi kami mahasiswa waktu itu untuk sama-sama mengetahui tentang apa saja yang terjadi dan ada isu-isu apa seputaran di ranah sosial, politik, dan juga budaya yang hadir, karena saat itu kami masih mahasiswa dan kebetulan saya juga kuliah di sekolah seni. Akan tetapi kehadiran ruang rupa tahun 2000 adalah merupakan satu bentuk dari berbagai macam pertanyaan tentang bagaimana kami ingin mendekatkan diri secara praktik artistik, karena kalian adalah seniman, dengan singgungannya dengan perkotaan, dengan masyarakat yang hidup di perkotaan, dan juga bagaimana dengan praktek-praktek artistik yang hadir dan tercipta dari lingkup-lingkup sosial yang sangat beragam di Jakarta. Karena kami mengetahui bahwa Jakarta sendiri adalah sebuah ibu kota yang sangat yang diisi oleh ragam masyarakat yang datang dan hadir karena juga urbanisasi isu, dan kemudian mereka tinggal di sini dan mereka mempunyai berbagai macam strategi sekaligus juga bagaimana bisa bertahan hidup dan mempunyai bentuk-bentuk dalam tanda kutip desain-desain yang baru, dan kemudian itu menciptakan dan membentuk kota yang akhirnya hadir seperti sekarang. Sorry if I go fast. Terima kasih. Lalu Dalam prakteknya, Ruang Rupa memang selalu berfokus pada pendekatan perkotaan. Bagaimana kami membaca sekeliling kami, bagaimana kami membaca tentang bertetangga, bagaimana kami membaca dengan sistem kekeluargaan, bagaimana kami membaca sebuah kota menjadi sebuah platform yang bisa kami mainkan, dalam artian mengkritisi, bermain, dan juga mempertanyakan. Karena di sini adalah kami melihat bentuk-bentuk yang sangat positif dari perkembangan-perkembangan yang hadir di perkotaan, terutama dengan isu yang berkaitan dengan praktek-praktek tentang kebudayaan, sosial, dan juga kesenian. Dan kami menemukan teman-teman seniman kami pun menjadi sebuah data bank untuk kita sama-sama saling membuat sebuah platform terlepas dari itu Ruang Rupa ataupun di luar Ruang Rupa. Tapi menurut kami lebih baik mencari teman dibanding mengetahui apa itu seni, karena itu adalah memulai bentuk-bentuk baru yang akan mendekatkan kami kepada sikap-sikap atau praktek-praktek artistik kami selama 15 tahun ini, dan itu yang membentuk. Dalam kaitannya perjalanan Ruang Rupa hingga sekarang, secara organisasi tentunya kami bilang bahwa tidak ada hierarki dalam Ruang Rupa, kami selalu berhubungan secara horizontal. Secara organisasi mungkin untuk kepentingan donatur, kami bilang ini adalah organisasi, kami punya director, kami punya manager, kami punya finance, eksekutif atau seperti itu. Akan tetapi pada prakteknya adalah kami selalu mengerjakan ini bersama-sama, karena menurut kami kebersamaan itu bukan dilihat sebagai satu hal yang romantis, tapi menurut kami kebersamaan itu justru yang membuat kami mengetahui perbedaan. Karena dalam Islam, itu yang kami ketahui, dalam Islam perbedaan adalah rahmat. Jadi kami harus selalu berbeda. Dan ini menjadi genuine untuk mencapai sebuah perbedaan, dan akhirnya satu sama lain saling mengerti itu adalah menjadi sebuah hal yang memang dibutuhkan, karena ini akan menampilkan sikap-sikap yang lebih arif dalam menghadapi atau melihat bentuk-bentuk yang namanya masalah yang terjadi, ataupun kita membahas atau mendiskusikan sebuah area perkembangan seni rupa misalkan, atau ada apa, termasuk juga mengkritisi kami selaku kolektif seniman dan juga program-program yang telah berjalan. Maka dari itu sebetulnya ini yang berusaha kami selalu tampilkan yang selalu kami pelajari dan selalu kami latih, karena 15 tahun adalah bukan waktu yang sebentar bagi kami untuk mendapatkan satu strategi atau siasat yang memang bisa sampai kemudian menjadi sebuah kolektif seniman, ataupun menjadi mungkin seperti yang Carlos sudah singgung, akhirnya kami berhasil menjadi tim kurator untuk Soundspace Exhibition di Arnhem tahun 2016. Dan pendekatan yang selalu kami tekankan adalah bukan selalu atau semata kami menjadi sebuah kolektif itu harus seperti apa, tapi kami lebih memikirkan bagaimana sih sebetulnya, apakah konteks yang kami tawarkan untuk bisa melihat bagaimana perkembangan seni rupa itu sebetulnya dibutuhkan atau tidak. Is it part of the necessity or it is like it should be like generic question, seperti itu. Jadi kami ingin membuat ini menjadi pertanyaan dan pertanyaan dan pertanyaan. Kami selalu berusaha membuat itu tidak fix, dan itu yang membuat yang memperkaya kami untuk kemudian bisa melangkah ke bentuk atau melihat bentuk-bentuk lain yang ada di sekitar kami. Maka dari itu ketika kami terpilih menjadi tim kurator untuk Soundspace International Exhibition, yang pertama kami perhatikan dan ingin kami perhatikan adalah tentang Arnhem-nya itu sendiri, tentang kotanya itu sendiri, tentang bagaimana kami bisa tinggal di sana, kami bisa mengetahui sejauh apa Arnhem menurut pengamatan kami itu sangat berrelasi dengan bagaimana secara personal kami punya pendekatan terhadap kota. Walaupun secara sederhana kami bisa mencari bahan-bahan ini melalui arkaik yang lain, akan tetapi kami mengalami bagaimana Arnhem secara kota mempunyai hubungan atau secara realistis bisa berhubungan dengan kami. Walaupun dalam satu kaitannya, penduduk Arnhem bisa saja tidak peduli dan acuh terhadap kami, bagi kami itu adalah satu hal yang menyenangkan, karena dengan begitu kami bisa membuktikan bahwa kalian arogan. Jadi ini yang menyenangkan. Jadi kita bisa bermain di situ, karena kita juga harus bisa melihat kemungkinan ataupun ada kemungkinan seperti apa yang bisa kami kemudian isi. Ada kemungkinan seperti apa yang kemudian bisa kami kerjakan bersama. Ada kemungkinan apa yang kemudian kita bisa memiliki satu pertanyaan yang sama mengenai Arnhem, mengenai penduduknya, mengenai Sunspec, ataupun event-event lain berkaitan di Arnhem, atau mungkin mengenai struktur Belanda itu sendiri bagaimana. Bagaimana secara historis itu berkaitan dengan bangsa Indonesia, bagaimana Arnhem secara kota mempunyai kaitan historis dengan Jakarta mungkin, atau dengan kota-kota lain. Dan hal yang hal seperti ini harusnya bisa didapatkan tidak hanya harus melalui satu institusi, tetapi melalui orang per orang. Maka dari itu, kepentingan pertama ketika kami pertama kali mengunjungi Arnhem adalah kami ingin bertemu orang atau bertemu seseorang yang kemudian setelah itu kami akan mempunyai beberapa pertanyaan dan kami akan mengalami hal ini bersama. Jadi maka itu tidak adalah menyenangkan ketika kami bertemu dengan ranger di Arnhem. Menurut kami itu adalah satu poin yang sangat berharga, selain akhirnya kemudian kami menemukan teman-teman baru yang lain dari institusi, dari sekolah, dari profesi yang lain yang kemudian bersinggungan dan akhirnya kami mempunyai kemungkinan untuk bekerja sama dalam bentuk yang lain. Lalu selanjutnya saat dalam tahapan ini mungkin kami masih membaca beberapa hal yang dapat kami singgungkan karena kami juga akan bekerja dengan beberapa seniman yang kemudian akan kami hadirkan di Sunspec Cultural Exhibition. Dan itu juga membuat kami harus bisa berelasi kemudian mengkomunikasikan kembali dengan para seniman ini untuk mendapatkan sebuah konteks yang dengan pendekatan kuratorial kami. Jadi inilah yang membuat kritiknya bagi kami adalah selaku kolektif kurator adalah kami harus bisa mengartikulasikan ini. Karena balik lagi, karena kami adalah tim of kurator dari sebuah kolektif dan setiap individu di dalam tim ini, di dalam kolektif ini mempunyai bagasi yang berbeda. Mempunyai pengetahuan dan latar belakang yang berbeda, menanggapi, melihat, merasakan, dan juga mengalami bagaimana kota bekerja, penduduk bekerja, bagaimana sebuah transaksi itu bisa terbaca, bagaimana nilai-nilainya itu bisa terlihat, misalkan, dan bagaimana transaksi ini tidak hanya untuk semata yang moneter. Jadi kami harus bisa membaca ini semua, dan itu harus berrelasi kemungkinan dengan ekspektasi dan kemudian terhadap acaranya itu sendiri. Jadi ini yang memang harus sedikitnya kami waspadai untuk bisa melihat dan mengetahui hal-hal semacam ini. Dan baiknya adalah karena kami ingin sekali memulai sesuatu dengan Sunspec itu adalah melalui kota. Jadi itu adalah hal yang menurut kami sangat realistis untuk bisa dihadapi karena kami sendiri selain kami tidak mengetahui Arnhem sebelumnya, tapi bagi kami sendiri itu adalah cukup dekat dan itu cukup itu adalah satu hal yang possible untuk bisa didekati karena kami senang untuk bertemu dengan teman baru, berbincang-bincang dengan orang yang lain, berbicara dengan dari berbagai golongan mungkin kami bisa mengetahui bagaimana masalah-masalah itu berkembang, bagaimana dengan gosip-gosip yang beredar misalkan oleh orang ke orang dan bagaimana itu dan itu kemudian melahirkan bentuk-bentuk yang membuat kami terinspirasi dan itu yang paling penting karena kami juga ingin terinspirasi dan itu yang selalu kami hadirkan dengan beberapa hal yang terjadi di ruang rupa bahwa kami harus bisa terinspirasi. selain kami juga punya tanggung jawab untuk menginspirasi. Jadi hal seperti ini yang memang selalu kami kedepankan, dan menurut kami hal ini yang membuat beberapa hal, satu halnya itu menjadi lebih realistis, dan menurut kami itu juga yang menjadikan dasar kami untuk bisa mengetahui bahwa ini adalah sebuah pendidikan yang lain, dan akhirnya kami bisa ketahui. Jadi video itu yang bisa saya jelaskan. Terima kasih banyak.
Commonalities emerging around the idea of preparation or being prepared, and I think that might be something that's interesting to come back to, you know, preparing the ground maybe longer for something, the preparation that was necessary for this supposedly spontaneous uprising in Gezi, and also the sense in which the preparation for Arnhem, for Zonsbeek, is changing your own practice. I think it would be nice to come back to those questions in a minute, and I hope that's a useful introduction also to think about the projects that Unji has been involved in the last few years, really, but also specifically with Shaka Bienale, I think, which is an issue of displacement of yourself to another location, but also bringing together a commonality of artists internationally, similarly to what we have try to do to some extent here in Sharjah, in a very different location with its own rules. So very happily hand over. I think actually it may be better to come here because I think the sound is better. Yeah. I think we're too far away.
Project which really demonstrates the spirit, a kind of, at least from the outside it appeared, a relatively non-hierarchical association with a curator from outside and a curator from inside. I really sense in the exhibition and also in just the way people interact, the way the team interacts, you know, a very successful project in my mind. Because there's a lot of, there's maybe a temporary new community that's been developed around this project. And those are the kinds of, values that I think we really have to think about within the so-called contemporary art world. Charles had talked a little bit, had spoken to me a little bit, Charles was very before, about thinking about Sharjah as a specific location.
We have two mics on.
Just trying to see why we're buzzing. About the maybe specific locality of Sharjah and how I approached that, and also thinking about peripheries and we had a long discussion, which I hope can be maybe dealt with a little bit in the discussion. Within the presentation, I just wanted to first say that it was great to hear, the previous speakers, like Reza, talking about learning over time and finding ways to be inspired. Zenyo, talking about preparing for something that you don't yet know what it is that you're preparing for. You know, Renzo really challenging us to challenge ourselves and our position, you know, that we have to be rigorous as art practitioners, to constantly, to be uncomfortable, within our critique of a system, you know, to think about where the critique is and what it's for and who's benefiting from this project of critiquing. And also, you know, earlier this morning, hearing people speak about the cosmos and the role of art as space making and welcoming the other is very related to ideas that I'm also thinking about. And, you know, to think about how artists play a social and philosophical role in society that's valuable beyond, sometimes beyond an immediate grasp. And I think that's just a preface to tell you a little bit about where we're going to go here, hopefully. So I wanted to talk a little bit about how I approached working in Sharjah. Sharjah is the third largest emirate in the United Arab Emirates. And it's a unique place with officially approximately 80% non-nationals living in the emirate. Maybe 60% of those non-nationals are from South Asia. This is a picture of most of the team, maybe actually only one third of the technical team because it was lunch break and everybody had to run. But to show you that within the foundation there are people working together in different roles from many different countries. There are Americans, there are Palestinians, there are Lebanese. Who else we have up there? Some Jordanians, some local Emiratis, a lot of people from Bangladesh, Pakistan, Kerala. And so together we communicate in English, but you can imagine that there are many languages that are represented within the team that reflect the emirate, and something that is that becomes important in producing a project and trying to imagine how you'll communicate with the public and how you'll have a long-standing, substantial relationship with the public, with the staff, and with the artists and each other internally. So, although everybody thinks of the Emirates as being a desert, it's both the desert and the Gulf, and water and sand are important to think about, and the meeting of the land. This is the Sharjah Creek, next to the heritage area, which is where the Sharjah Biennial takes place, primarily. This is one of the plazas outside of the Sharjah Art Museum. And here I'm gonna give you a little bit of information of the approach. So when I was asked to do the Sharjah Biennial, it comes after some years of engagement with the Sharjah Art Foundation, which was founded in 2008. The Sharjah Biennial was actually founded in 1993, and it focused on international but regional art. And in the early 2000s, took on a slightly different role to think about a larger international art that was inspired mostly by Okwie Nwezu's Document 11. So the Sheikha of Sharjah, the daughter of the leader of Sharjah, came back from London, from art school, after having seen the Documenta, and said, I want to try to make a more international exhibition here at Sharjah. And so she invited her professor, Peter Lewis, from the Slade, to co-curate an exhibition with her in 2002-2003. And from this point on, the biennial started to take an international perspective, I would say, that was quite different than before. I was aware of the biennial probably only since the late 2000s, but then had the great fortune to go several times to Sharjah and to Dubai and have an experience that where it was a real place and a real movement of artists and organizers trying to develop infrastructure. And this is what I was really interested in a place where, you know, I totally respect what Renzo's saying, that there were many biennials that were started as a kind of gentrification process or a kind of idea to develop tourism. And I think this is, in part, you know, of course, it's not separated here in Sharjah, but in Sharjah there was also an objective that has to do with supporting the production of art in the region. And there are many programs that the foundation has developed to support the production of art and artist residencies. And for me, you know, it was really important that Sharjah was operating outside of the main Western or Western train centers and was trying to develop an infrastructure. And this is something that among colleagues who have been in the so-called periphery of Western European art, you know, something that we've been discussing for many years, how could the biennial also have a positive function? And one of those positive functions would be to develop our infrastructure where there's no museums, there's no commercial system, there's maybe no education system, or within the education system, contemporary is not taught. So these are like ideals that we shared. And so when I started to learn about Sharjah, I was very interested in this possibility of assisting the infrastructure by using, importing some of the information that I was able to gather from being based in the United States, in the hopes that we could help them with their development of infrastructure. For Sharjah Biennial specifically, I began with a conversation with the artist Jan Bo, who's a friend of mine. And Jan asked me the question about, you know, it was kind of a moment where I was thinking that there was no point for contemporary art, that maybe I should, you know, it's kind of an existential moment where I thought maybe we should just stop. And he said, you know, but why are you interested in contemporary art? And why were you ever interested in contemporary art? And I told him, you know, there are moments within contemporary art that if even overly utopic or overly idealistic, where I begin to see the manifestation of something that I can only describe as freedom. And that's, you know, maybe only in the mind or something in it, but it's something that I feel is valuable. You know, to think about how we can continue to work. And Jan said to me, he thinks it's much more important to think about, you know, how contemporary art can help us to overcome the limitations of history, a history that continues to haunt, how artists offer a way of thinking abstract enough to suggest new realities, and how curators could approach exhibition making better. He reminded me of the need to use artist positions to consider new possibilities for social organization, to consider how to reorganize systems and how to rearrange cultural and political confinement. And so these ideas constitute the departure point for the biennial. So I wanted to approach this with special attention to the ways of working, how we could maybe have a sustained engagement with the public, the staff, and each other. The title, The Past, the Present, the Possible, comes from an essay called The Red City by Henri Lefebvre. It's a sentence that says something to the effect that the past, the present, the possible cannot be separated. And I was thinking specifically in terms of the impasse that we were at, that I feel that we are at, with the rising stakes of the market and the lessening stakes of artistic thinking. That maybe we should take a look at that essay, think about the present, think about how the city is reforming and how we might have to take a new view of the city. It's not so much from a sociological or urban studies position, but I thought it was interesting that in 1967, the Fed was already writing about you know, what were the stakes of the new city and shouldn't the citizens or the inhabitants of the city have more than just basic satisfaction. And I wanted to think about what role does art play in attaining more than just satisfaction, or just going to work, coming home from work, you know, just having a place to live, that's not enough of a goal for life. I also wanted to think think about how we could transform, or I always want to think about how we can transform our critiques of the so-called contemporary art world into the art world that we deserve. I think that this is something, you know, that many practitioners here in this room work on constantly, which is, you know, to actually manifest a different way of thinking, a different way of working, a different way of determining values. And finally, you know, to think about artistic thinking as this, you know, what Jan was saying, artistic thinking is possibly the only way we can get past an impasse. And so how then is the artist a social being, an actor? The structure of the biennial gratefully, because there is some funding for the biennial in Sharjah, I think we had a production budget which included travel and accommodation and production of works of about $1.3 million. It's a lot of money. I think it's probably three times what I'd ever worked at before. Now maybe this is the speed with which you should look at these images. So with this money, there were several things that I thought we could do that would be important. And first was to bring all the artists, or as many as we could. Eventually I would invite 51 artists, but at the time, about a year before the biennial started, I had already identified approximately 25 artists that I wanted to invite to make new production. So I thought the first thing we might be able to do was to engage with the artists through group research trips so that they could learn a little bit about the actual space that they were going to be working in, and so that the public could have initial interaction with the artists before they produce their work, so that their own, you know, so that their knowledge of these art, these practices could be beyond the final exhibition. Maybe learn a little bit about what the artists were thinking generally about the practice of art and generally about the role of artists. I don't know where we are here, so I'm going to actually, if you go back a little bit, I'm going to pass you this so that you can just put through your little tab. Do you want to just do it from there? So you're just seeing images, random images of the research trips that we did with artists. Over the course of the first 6 months of preparing for the biennial, which opened in March of 2015, probably in March of, in February, March of 2014, we brought about 20 artists to do group site visits. They attended lectures by local scholars about the development of the emirate and the development of the port and the development of the city. Formation of the UAE. They traveled to the East Coast, because Sharjah is the only emirate that actually goes from the Gulf, the Arabian Gulf, to the Gulf of Oman. They saw the landscape, and we have this incredible opportunity, which is reflected in these images, of also working closely with the director of archaeology, who took us into archaeological sites, but also across the emirate to interact with, you know, active archaeological sites to learn the history of the area. There was recently, within the last 5 years, archaeological discoveries which connect Sharjah to the so-called Southern Rock, which is the exodus from Ethiopia through the Gulf, that date man's presence in Leha, which is just outside of downtown, to 125,000 years ago. And so here you see a picture of the Art of Baron Kim above a petroglyph field that we visited, where just in the open air you can still see petroglyphs that were made probably 20,000 years ago or something. It was important for the artists to have this kind of time so that they would see the space. I mean, I think it's important to note that we had the money to do this, because many biennials don't have the money to bring artists repeatedly. But since we did have the money, it was important to me that artists would come, they would spend some time in the space, they would travel the country, they would talk to people, they would wander around and get lost. But it was also important that they, you know, made some public presentations. And so there's also images that you'll be here. Good timing. Where we took over the March meeting, which is an annual meeting that happens in Sharjah, every year, also during the biennial years. And this was an off year between biennials, and the biennial period doesn't normally carry the March meeting. But I thought it would be a really great chance to share information from both directions, meaning we had, you know, artists working in the so-called region, and also scholars who are working on studying urban planning, or critiquing the urban plan of Sharjah and the development of heritage. We had artists talk about their practices, but also we had practitioners from other countries talk about collection building, talk about different kinds of exhibitions. You know, it was a kind of information share, you know, so that we would develop a kind of internal community that could go on to work together over the course of the next year and a half. For the March meeting in 2014, we surrounded it with these group site visits that I was explaining to you. And then beyond that, artists continued to come and do at least 5 days research in the area. This impacted some projects. We made, in the end, 36 artists made new work and commissions. I would say only about 20 or so of those were made in situ in Sharjah. A lot of the new work was actually made in Los Angeles or Paris or wherever, and was brought to Sharjah. But many artists were able to work in Sharjah. And one of the goals of that was to also, within the concept of developing infrastructure, was to have a kind of long-term project where the staff of the Sharjah Art Foundation would be interacting with the artists as they develop their projects. Because one of the things that I saw were that there were super capable technicians, but they didn't know very much about art. They weren't included in the discussions of how an artwork might develop over time. They oftentimes had a very functional relationship to the work that was being developed. And I thought, you know, the first tier of communication could be around the staff itself and their understanding more of how artists work and their understanding of what it takes or what risks might be at play that are not evident at first might have a lasting impact that would be important for the foundation over time. One of the other things that I asked for, make a few interventions within the city outside of the foundation itself. The foundation is located, as I said, in the heritage area. During the biennial, they use a museum. They use a series of new art spaces that were developed specifically for the Sharjah Art Foundation in recent years. And they use some existing historic buildings. It's a beautiful space with incredible possibilities for artists to work, but it's an isolated space in a way. It's a certain part of the city. And so we wanted to see if we could intervene in other parts of the city and break the wall that existed between the foundation and the people who live in the city. So one of the things that we did was to try to find spaces outside of the foundation area. And we were able to access warehouses that are on the port, on Port Holland. We were able to access a abandoned ice factory on the East Coast in Calaba. We were able to access unused land within the city. And we were also able to do performance within the streets of the city that kind of brought people back into the foundation area, which was, as I said, where I started. Here you're looking at images on the East Coast where I wanted to show this kind of variety of images just so that you could see that the landscape is kind of important. It's, when you saw those pictures earlier of artist Akhil Chopra and Tara Shinoda standing in the desert, I think it was 50 degrees Celsius out, and it was Ramadan, so unfortunately our drivers couldn't even drink water, from 4:30 in the morning till after dusk. The landscape becomes a huge factor in time and how you experience space. And when artists were there experiencing the heat and experiencing, a largely observant community, it had a great impact on the work, I think. And what we found in the end was that a lot of the works were very meditative. They required a very long presence in to experience them. The team had a great investment. Here you're seeing some series of images of tests that the team was doing with artists in order to determine, in this case, the amount, the size of a hole that would allow sand to fall over a 2-week period of time for a project by Tara Shinoda. And here, just whether or not an 8-meter-long boat would fit through the front door of the space. So it was made for some hard work to check it out. Here, what kind of sand would work the best in Cynthia Marcel's piece, The Return of the Real, in which she covered the ceiling of this courtyard with sieves and had workers pounding the ceiling so that sand would fall at different places, at different times. And, to think about both labor conditions in the Gulf and also, the extreme power of the environment on the way people live. Eduardo Navarro worked with school children over the course of several months to develop a game of non-competition for children. Eventually, he made a game that was based in the senses. So here's some children from the Hindu school doing blind drawing exercises and working with their teachers and artists to find modes of communication that were beyond speech. And Michael Ju worked very closely with the team at Sharjah to transform this warehouse space into a work that's about time and about thinking about the history of irrigation and, mankind taking over the land. He worked with he trained 23 technicians to install a silver nitrate wall. And many workers worked with Peggy Young to transform this crazy courtyard, overgrown courtyard called Bad Abubi. She worked with people from the Heritage Department into a sculptural intervention called An Opaque Wind. This is the final project by Cynthia Marcel. And this is Papi Obotani's Fanfare Funerai, which took place in the area outside of the museum. This is Tara Shinoda's Karasin Suite. Michael Ju's final project in the warehouse. Peggy Young's Opaque Wind. Gary Simmons did an amazing project, which was a youth-sized cricket field called Across the Chalk Line, in which he scaled down a cricket field for kids. There's very few places, safe places for children to play. So he worked with our team to use some unused space in the foundation. And actually, you can kind of see it to the left. We opened the door. There's a gate that surrounds the foundation area. And we opened a door, which is always locked for some reason. That makes it very difficult to come into the foundation. You have to walk all the way around the Marantia. But, you know, to kind of break the barrier between the city and the foundation and keep this cricket field open day and night, you know, hundreds and hundreds of children would play in that space. Adriana Charrojas took over the factory in Calda and made an intervention of sedimented sculptures, which incorporated materials from that mostly that he had collected in Sharjah, but also from other locations. I didn't include so many of the final works because I wanted to just talk about more the plan than the product. The product is, you know, something that you'll find in the soon to be published catalog, you know, where you can see. I was hoping that it would be here, that they would FedEx it here, but they're still binding the books. But it's something that you can see in the documentation. But I wanted to show these images to talk about working together to form a community, you know, of artists, to think about the art world that we want to work in and the ways that we want to work with each other, and how, you know, oftentimes when we work on an exhibition or biennial, rather than the end, you know, that the exhibition or the period of showing and producing works, rather than the end, it's, you know, for me, always the beginning. It's the beginning of conversation. It's the beginning of a series of relationships, and it's the beginning of, you know, ways of thinking that influence each other and have producing effects over time.
Thanks a lot. That was really sort of a comprehensive way of talking through the preparation for the project, which was kind of nice in terms of the preparation. That's the thought. And also, I think interesting that for me, what was interesting is that the fact that you did these research visits, that it was quite sort of extensive in traveling around the country, seemed, or whatever, seems to have affected the work itself, the nature of the work. Like there are works that artists were making, those that I knew that were not necessarily completely classically within their own practice, but were actually quite different. That the pace you talked about at the time, and I think that's very interesting. Like how much the location changes it. And I mean, maybe that's an interesting place to start when we talk about cosmopolitanism, about the extent to which the location and our sense of location is actually constrained cosmopolitanism. In its classical sense, that the first category, the kind of the cosmopolitan of people, as Nikos was talking about. But maybe then also about certain ideas of making worlds to happen, but those worlds are not complete worlds, but they're worlds of a particular area, of a particular culture, and they allow diversity. I'm always resistant to the idea of pluralizing the idea of worlds. There was once a Venice Biennale that was called Making Worlds, which I always thought absurd, because as Alain Badiou and many other people have said, there is only one world. And part of the reason that we have these constraints and these struggles is because there is only the one world, and there are not endless possible creations. So I think we have to see the unique aspect of the world, as well as the possible diversity within that, and that singularity. I'm wondering whether I could start, I hope there are some questions, but I wonder if I could start around this question of locations by asking Assel if he could talk about how moving to Arnhem to some extent, or at least relocating your practice in the Netherlands, how much has that changed the work of the collective? Do you see it different from how it is in Jakarta, and what are the differences that you're negotiating?
Terima kasih, Kau. Terima kasih untuk panelis yang lain yang sudah bicara jauh tentang bagaimana sifat atau posisi dan juga kemudian yang menentukan apa itu politik dan bagaimana politik itu bekerja. Berdasar pada pengalaman dari apa yang gua lakukan kerjakan selaku politik seniman atau kami menemukan, sebetulnya ketika kami menemukan Ahmed, salah satu hal yang kami ingin ketahui pertama kali adalah tentang orang-orang, tentang penduduknya. Karena itu yang memang berusaha kami relasikan dengan bagaimana kemudian setelah kami bertemu, lalu apa yang akan kami lakukan. Itu adalah pertanyaan yang menjadi dasar bekerja kami secara kolektif. Dan setiap orang di setiap individu di luar rumah yang memang terlibat sebagai tim kurator untuk konflik internasional exhibition ini mempunyai pendekatan-pendekatan yang berbeda berdasar pada praktek-praktek yang setiap individu lakukan di Jakarta. Jadi di Jakarta pun kami menemukan bahwa setiap individu yang berada di luar rumah, mereka mempunyai jaringan-jaringan kerja tersendiri yang terkadang berkaitan satu sama lain, tapi terkadang tidak ada hubungannya baik itu dengan luar rumah, baik itu dengan luar rumah, dan juga baik itu dengan kegiatan atau program lain yang ada di Jakarta. Ketika kami menemukan kami, dan ketika kami akhirnya mampu berinteraksi, yang kami bawa dari Jakarta, yang kami namakan kolektif ini kemudian menjadi tantangan, menjadi sebuah tantangan, tapi juga itu sebagai pemicu yang bisa membuat kami mempunyai satu strategi di mana kami mempunyai satu strategi di mana strategi ini yang kemudian kami nilai bahwa inilah yang akan kami lakukan. Jadi ini tentang bagaimana kami juga mempunyai sebuah posisi tanpa harus mengganggu struktur Armin itu sendiri, baik itu kaitannya dengan beberapa organisasi, komunitas, ataupun apa yang telah terjadi di Armin. Akan tetapi kami juga memposisikan di mana apa yang sebaiknya kami isi di Armin. Jadi kami tidak melihat Armin mempunyai yang pasti setiap kota, setiap negara sudah pasti berhadapan dengan masalah, dengan kelemahan, dengan ketidakmampuan. Akan tetapi yang paling pasti bahwa setiap individu di dalamnya itu mempunyai potensi-potensi. Dan biasanya potensi-potensi ini tidak begitu terlihat karena terkadang individu yang mempunyai potensi ini memang harus berada dalam satu faktor, harus selalu berada dalam satu wadah, dan kemudian akhirnya tidak terlihat. Dan ini yang sebetulnya cukup sulit untuk kami temukan. Apalagi kami melihat Armin sendiri merupakan potensi yang lain yang sebetulnya tidak jauh berbeda dengan apa yang terjadi di Jakarta. Akan tetapi kami melihat hubungannya bagaimana pola berpikir kolektif ini juga menjadi satu hambatan karena di situ beragam pandangan yang itu di situ banyak sekali pandangan-pandangan yang lain yang kami lihat maksudnya bagaimana sistem bekerja secara individual, bagaimana juga secara ego, bagaimana juga kemudian menghadapi kami dari Jakarta. Mungkin pertanyaannya kalau itu sebenarnya ada sebuah pengalaman yang sangat personal. Kalau itu saya pergi dari Chelsea Hub menuju Armin Central, dan dalam sebuah bis saya berbincang dengan seorang, ada seorang penumpang, dia bertanya dari mana saya berasal. Terus saya bilang, kami, saya dari Jakarta dan kami bagian dari kolektif dari tim kurator yang berkesan. Lalu dia bertanya, mengapa kalian harus sejauh ini menjadi kurator berkesan? Apakah tidak ada warga Armin atau warga Belanda atau bahkan dari Eropa sendiri yang memang mau menjadi kurator sampai dan memikirkan bagaimana sampai tidak akan berjalan? Itu adalah pertanyaan yang cukup sulit dan tapi menyenangkan karena inilah yang saya tangkap sebagai bentuk pemikiran kolektif ya. Dan ini yang memang selalu kami hargai. Lalu saya bilang, ya mungkin ini adalah satu kesempatan di mana kami selaku warga Belanda atau
kepedulian, mengetahui kemungkinan-kemungkinan lain yang terjadi untuk membandingkan dengan pertanyaan kalian, kenapa kok tidak ada orang lain yang mau berhubungan dengan arsitek, misalkan, atau kenapa kok tidak ada warga Belanda lain, dan mungkin kenapa juga warga Eropa saat ini tidak berhubungan dengan walaupun di sisi lain, maka kami terpilih karena memang ada beberapa operator lain yang itu menjadi saingan kami untuk konsep, beberapa konsep itu juga ini pertanyaan yang saya jawab dengan pertanyaan juga sebetulnya. Tapi terlepas dari itu, ini adalah membuat kami merefleksikan diri kenapa Ruang Rupak mau sejauh ini bekerja di sana, mau merelasikan diri dengan Arne, mau kemudian mencari identitas lain yang berhubungan dengan potensi yang seharusnya ini dilakukan oleh warga Arne itu sendiri. Tapi ini yang membuat kami tertantang kemudian untuk membuat Arne ataupun siapapun yang ada di dalamnya menjadi sparring kami. Bagaimana kami bisa bekerja bersama, bagaimana kami bisa menemukan pengalaman-pengalaman yang berbeda, bagaimana kami bisa bersama untuk membentuk satu pengetahuan yang lain. Ini adalah Arne, dan ini adalah kami mengidentifikasi Arne seperti ini. Dan kami tahu apa yang harus kami lakukan, terlepas dari sikap atau pemikiran yang sangat individual. Tapi terlepas dari itu, yang menarik dan yang berharga menurut kami adalah kita berbagi pengalaman. Karena semua pendekatan artistik itu adalah berhubungan dengan pengalaman. Jadi itu yang memang membuat kami termotivasi untuk bisa terus melihat problem-problem ini juga menjadi problem ini juga menjadi satu bahan proses artistik kami untuk kemudian mempunyai pendekatan kuratorial di art novel.
Thank you, Asa. I've got one more question for Renzo, and then we can maybe go to some other questions. To what extent would you see what you're doing as a preparation for something else?
Yeah,
I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, take it as one of the great things. I think proper engagement with the world necessarily starts with properly understanding it and assessing what's the condition within the world one they want to perceive. I guess we all kind of agree on that one. And I think the act of, first of all, understanding that post-colonial critique in Amsterdam is not at the same time the focal force 10 kilometers further are filled with the unpaid labor of millions of mostly African, South American, Asian people. It's that. That is the beginning. Point two would be that if we address it as human capital, all types of capital, not just money, but not just knowledge, intimacy, etc. But it does so in only a few places in the world. And these happen to be also the places where the other types of capital, the ones of just pure economic exploitation, are being made more often than not. So that's just the that's the study part, it's like the past, so to speak, and the present, because obviously it needs to be something else than that. One thing that came out of the last group meeting we organized, it was called the Matter of Critique, was that the place where we're now working had been uprised in 1931 by the Mapelle, which is one particular ethnic group of people, you should say, who were forced labor for Unilever. And then all of their artistic production was stopped and forbidden by Unilever and its colonial state agents. Even if, of course, that they continue up to this day to sponsor artistic production through their labor unpaid readings for Unilever, including the Unilever series and the Modern, are indirectly paid for by companies that they workers. Including really fantastic renditions of the material labor by Tino's developer, for example, paid for by very real labor by unpaid, who are not anymore allowed to make art. Okay, so that's the place where we built the center. And basically all the same things that you tried to do in China are happening now. Of course, the hub, the museum will be in bamboo. And the library will have most of its books in Kikongo and English and French. But we're trying to build a real center for art and critical engagement. Because I think the type of knowledge that can be generated there is very different than what could be generated in obviously Amsterdam or New York, but even different from the capital Kinshasa. Because we're really in the production zone with people who have been part and parcel of that production. So, yeah, through a few schemes, a lot of things are starting to happen now. I was saying that we attracted anthropologists and people who want to change the plantation. It's probably for a reason that the plantation that still is now working for Unilever pushes out. And luckily some people from that plantation followed us and we got everybody out of jail. I can't disclose all the plans, but the idea is to make sure that it's going to bring a lot of money and a lot of turmoil to that place. But in a soft and silent way, because of course it's virtually a dictatorship, almost. And it's not a dictatorship because there's a local ruler who's a dictator, it's a dictatorship because it's on the basis of capital. And all the interventions that are funded by capital are not self-conscious in a way. They pretend to be about social engagement, but most of the money goes to self-employed, et cetera, et cetera. So we plan a big event soon, if and when, you know, it's a short, we'll announce it. But I think it's going to stir up a few things in general.
Thank you, it's fascinating, particularly this history of the dog. But
there's so much to do also. I think when you speak, I don't know whether that was a term you used, the reverse colonialism, of course you're not going to colonize Ireland, but certainly that you bring this model of collaboration that you've been experiencing with for so many years here. This is something we of course desperately need in Europe, yeah, to go beyond Ireland. And that's why people really should and do, I hope, accentuate open arms. I think it's important that these different types of self-awarenesses can shift throughout the globe in the places where it really matters and where it's not just an exercise in self-righteousness.
Excellent. Are there any questions? All the artists will be around, but there's one question at the back, one there. Is there a third one? Well, so three. Can we start with Fernando again? And then if we gather all three and then we can answer them in turn.
Thank you. Yeah. It's as difficult as for us to hear you. Well, it was a complex but very rich in set of different presentations, and I think they all bring the question of the moment of transition, or maybe hopefully a transformation of the notion of the moment of the Biennale, for example, from an event to a relation with a process. There's a relation with politics and the art form or the culture we produce, but also at the same time the political economy of art, in the sense of the notion of event in the Biennale of being a city brand, basically origin or source of raison d'etre, and at the same time maybe having the potential of exchanging, transforming, and social construction of a cosmos, not that Nico was saying before, but it's in betweenness, no, that we are now, and it was interesting to see from Sarja, no, maybe the discovery of education as a kind of a new continent to explore, no, from the notion of a Biennale that otherwise, and I'm not an expert in the history of this specific form of presentation of the art in established art was, but maybe a perceived, as you were saying, no? Maybe another notion of the potential of the Biennale as engaged with other
dimension of a process and not an event. I found very interesting, you know, how to navigate between that conflicting and difficult relation, for example, in the case of staying up, you know, how you try at this moment to, or it just may happen that there is a distance between the political process you are in and the art form that appears in the Biennale, you know, so, or in other, in any other form of appearance in established art context. And that, it's also very interesting in relation to how we do together, how we relate these different forms of approaching and how we dislocate and relocate politics and art. And I just wanted to bring attention because the difficulty on, for example, for me to understand events or in your case, no, the approach to a context that has a specific problematic, no? To try to dislocate yourself actually into that context. As a contrast from the strategy that Rula Rufo was, for example, following, say, I come as a neighbor, I come as a friend, and I engage in art in a completely alien context, and I try to nurture a relationship. In your case, I understand that you are focusing on highlighting the problem and the problematic of that relation itself. And apart from highlighting that problem, you make a proposal. The proposal of using the political economy of art, the gentrification mechanism, and the exploitation of media as a way to bring knowledge around, empower that community. No? But I don't know if that message is really reaching even the supposed community you relocate yourself, you know, even in your work, you intentionally kind of enlarge the alien position, no? of the journalist, or the explorer, or the master. But I wonder if this is the way to go. Sorry for the question. But just to ask, if you have thought, for example, in other strategies or tactics, like with Passet in Senegal, which is building a craft cooperative in a village, work that you, we can see here, for example, I did not discuss that before, no? But how to maybe move from the knowledge of the problem and the connection with that discourse that is only being meaningful for the Western audience in order to make it on other more meaningful processes that are like that. Thanks. Yeah, maybe something to do with process and to the extent to which Charger was more process than presentation, I think might be interesting. And then for Randall, I think I can summarize maybe to what extent your practice of denunciation is sufficient, or do you see it as a practice of only a denunciation, or is there something else? Can I get a couple of other questions before we turn back? I'll just do three and then we'll do another round of three. So you were second, I think. Yeah, the woman in the front, the black shirt, and another one. I think it was, yeah, with you in the yellow shirt, and then we'll come back to the panel.
Hi everyone, I have a good question for you, okay? I'm very much interested to hear about how the local reacted to the Georgia Biennale. So if you could elaborate more on that aspect.
Thank you very much. This is for just a quick word with that. Thanks for the collective letter of Rupa. What is it called? Rupa. I'm learning your language. It's actually not a question. I just want to learn more. I'm from Kampala. And I think in Kampala we don't have any collective. I'm not so sure, but I think there is no collective. And I think if there's any, then they don't practice very well, because we don't know them. And I also think if they are there, then maybe they don't know the definition of a collective. So for the 15 years that you've been evolving your group, would you find a simple word that describes a collective, so when I go back I can share with them?
Thank you. So maybe I can start with Unji, and then go to Rizzo, and then to Asom. About process versus presentation, and about the audience reaction.
I like that summary that it was about process and presentation. I mean, of course, finales depend on a certain amount of spectacle. That's what they are. You know, that's part of the festival mentality within a limited time and a limited space. I think that, you know, as practitioners, we have a long investment in what we're doing, and when you are asked as a curator to do a biennial, you have this opportunity that you can also share with the artists that you're already engaged with, and hopefully share with the artists that you don't yet know. But you also have the opportunity yourself to learn. You know, it's an ongoing process of challenging the way you think. So I would like to believe that we're engaged in the process so that, you know, our practice as curators is also growing along the way. With regards to how the public responded, I mean, it's very difficult to say. I've seen numbers that say that 900,000 people came to the biennial, but I don't believe that. Or not, no, couldn't be honest, it must have been 90, but even those numbers are very hard to tell. There's many, many spaces. I think there's, you know, they're connected physically, but there are many different spaces, and the way they count who comes into which building is very difficult. But we had good attendance, both locally and internationally. There have been reviews that, you know, criticize it for not being political, reviews that say it's very political, it's intellectual, it's not intellectual, interesting, it's not interesting. When I mentioned very early in the talk something about language and how there are many different people, there's a large diversity of people in many different languages. One of the things that we did with the work, one of the things that I did with the commissions was to de-emphasize works that were solely about language. So there's actually quite a small number of, by annual standards of video, there's a small number of work, text-based work, because I wanted to focus on experiential works that could maybe not be limited by translations and things like this. That seemed to have worked fairly well, and we did see a lot of people coming into the spaces who maybe haven't been to the foundation before, and we, you know, anecdotally have heard positive things about people's experiences.
Do you want to answer the question about to what extent it's denunciation?
Yeah. So the question of whether denunciation is enough and whether it has any relevance really for the people of the foundation, put it very shortly. Well, I just try to explain to you why I believe it is absolutely necessary to build a center that deals with art and economic equality on the foundation. That's why I need to change or what I believe to be the status quo of critical art production as it functions now within the mostly Western-based art institutions.
How to articulate collectivities or even collective without any substance of practice. Because, like, sometimes, I mean, for us, or even for me personally, the word for collective is derived from the English word. So sometimes it's also difficult, because sometimes if we translate to Bahasa, it's becoming like short of perkumpulan or perkumpul, or it's kind of like related to the hangout, or it's related to gather, something like that. But of course, as a collective, sometimes it's also related to what so-called organization, or the part of the how we organize ourselves as a part of this collective. But in a way, it's not that easy, I mean, in the sense of, like, is it necessary to build up a collective in Kampala, for example? But in the sense, like, a collective, it should not be as a new body, or, like, as something physical. It could be, like, more as a, like, collective mindset, collective thoughts, like, things like that. I mean, this kind of, sometimes, the collective could be translated easy as just simple as how you choose the same song in the karaoke, for example, and then you could sing all together. I mean, the sense, this is like very practical to find out the sense of collectiveness. But I think even for us, we cannot like really suggest you about the, this is a good method for you to build a collective in Kampala or stuff like that. I mean, we don't want to do that in the sense, like if you don't need it, don't need it. I mean, if you don't need it, that's good for you to build a collective, so one homework is good for you now, yeah? So, but in the sense, like if you need it, so you can, I think it's a good way to find out exactly what is collective for Kampala. Because in the sense, if we could have this kind of a different type of collectiveness, so I think it's going to be challenged to each other, and then it's going to grow more of this kind of knowledge, because every local entity has a different kind of a knowledge, especially related to the tradition, especially related to the social engagement in the world contemporary today, something like that. So I think that's what I could say more.
And we're going to have one more round of three questions. And one over there. Yeah. Okay, I think we'll do four. Yeah. Can we start here?
I'm Silulu. I'm from the Democratic Republic of Congo. I see what Mr. Randall's doing. It's okay, I appreciate that, you know. But I think it's not doing it for the whole country. It's for just a specific type of people. And after doing that, people can watch that movie. It's just a movie, you know? And people that will watch that will feel bad. But it doesn't help Congolese, because we don't see that. Because when I googled about Renzo after, I saw on the internet that it was a big man. And I see his movies that are well known in the world. But in Congo, people are not interested. But it doesn't help us. And we don't see that. So I think his way of approaching the way of changing things might be changed to what Congolese people are interested to. So that when people are interested in what he's doing, and then he can give that message. So that the whole country can be aware of what's happening.
Thank you. Can we go over to Yanni at the back, or come back, or okay, that way.
Hi. I actually want to, because I think one of the things that sort of came up, especially with the process of Biennale, I think I saw a lot of pictures of accessing places where, you know, normally as a citizen of the city, I may not be able to access. I think if we think about Biennales and think about this whole idea of this global idea of Biennales, where every city would have a Biennale, the city government is very complicit in having the Biennale. So I think that one of the interesting about Biennale systems is that all Biennale organizations that you have the access to places where you could not access, where people could not access. And that means that there are certain possibilities there. And that's one of the things I thought was quite interesting. And another thing that I thought sort of came up quite interesting is the idea of building the, if artists or the art world wants to build the art world that you want to see. And I think that is quite essential. Because I think the art world is slightly different from this planet you are in, that one world. Because obviously, what you want to watch in Hong Kong and what we want to watch in Jakarta or somewhere else is going to be different. But I think that the problem that sometimes comes with this globalization that we think that there is the global art, whether it be nice, if the art world, with you, the people, the historians, the artists, do we spend enough time to sort of excavate the local knowledge? How do we kind of start to talk about that? Because I think that, I mean, it's great, because like today I have this symposium, I have this little translating device, right? And there's some man behind talking, so that I can actually start to understand a little bit, right? But the interesting thing is that I think that local knowledge is not just a translation of words, a thank you, Because there are so much things that are untranslatable. How do we kind of deal with that? I think that's something that we do need to look at, because it's quite specific, in order to excavate the true knowledge and true value so that other people can learn.
Thank you. Okay, there's quite a lot of people, so I'm going to take comments and things, and then we'll respond to those comments that we feel most urgent, because I'd like to hear voices. So, Remco, if you want to go now, and then over here, and then Yanni, and then Nikos, and then we'll have a seat, see if anybody else wants. Please.
I was really thinking about how to link all of the presentations, and I was struggling a bit. But I want to come back to this to your project, this disobedience. So, and I think you were a bit disobedient not to respond to that, or to ask that question. For me, that was maybe that's a kind of link that I see between the presentations. So I was wondering, as a kind of simple gesture, and see who picks it up, is if we could talk a bit about this idea of disobedience, of how you see that part of your practice.
Thank you. Will you go over to the blue shirted man?
Thank you.
Thank you, but I heard two what sounded to me like paradoxes, especially in Renzo's speech. So, the first one was in the video that you showed, it showed us how the setting up of the institute looked. Some of the Unilever flag was red. So I was wondering about that, why was the Unilever flag like red? And the other paradox that I heard was, at some point in the video we saw that at the center, that Renzo's therapy logo, the flag of the company Unilever was red. It's almost as if it were the logo of the center, or as if it were the sponsor of the center. So I was wondering about the reasons behind that. And the other thing is, at some point, I thought you said the more institutions like the Venice Biennale invite African artists, the more they consolidate their attitude as colonial. So I was wondering, what are institutions like the Venice Biennale, according to you, supposed to do to get rid of that attitude?
Thank you. Nikos, can we go and then we go over to Yanni? I'm not forgetting you.
Just briefly about the point of disobedience. The problem with disobedience as a concept, which I mentioned as well, is that it still reinstates the role of the master. So we have that dynamic of the master slaving disobedience that still retains itself. But I have a question for Zeno and Yunji about the recolonization of the concept of play and teamwork that appeared in both your presentations. Yunji, you talked about, and you showed us the cricket pitch that it was reactivated, and Zeno, you talked about the construction of an alternative soccer league. I'm really interested in this because of the way in which sport has become, just like art to some extent, is a place of play, and yet the instrumentalization, not just the corruption at this mega level, but the instrumentalization around competition towards professionalization, not competition towards play as an outcome, but competition towards professionalization, even at the level of children, has become so corrosive that I suspect that the power of one of the gestures that's implicit in both those examples is the recolonization of the space for playing the kids.
Nice. Can we go over to Yanni? Are there any other comments? I don't want to silence anybody at all. So then we'll go. There's one from research. And then one more. Two. Three. Ah, there. So we'll go to two more, and then that's it, I think, unless somebody's very urgent. pissed off with you for not speaking. Kelly.
I'm interested, I mean, appreciated what Fred's featuring, but I would like to hear more, actually, because I can't really hear clearly also what he explained before. I'm interested because I'm also doing something in a way similar, and have similar kind of concern, and I have been also working with the community outside Indonesia, like you are doing something in Congo and doing something in Tibet. So this is, I think, interesting, although maybe it's a different situation. I would like to know, for example, maybe you don't have to explain this now because we don't really have the time, but I'm really interested in how you are working with the community there, and how do you finance the project? And as I learned so far, that as if you have a kind of long-term project, as you want to build an art center and I don't know what else, sounds like a long-term project, deal with the authority or the policy makers in that country or in that area. Yeah, so this is a lot of questions, but just answer maybe one simple question, and then later you can explain me. Yeah, thank you.
Here, and then to anyone else?
Yes. I'm Ivan from Pakistan. I just wanted about one thing about your presentation in Bengal and Chadwick. I started the story that you told us that the daughter of the leader, when she came back and she saw the comment at 11, and she told Daddy that she wants something like this in Sharjah. And it's obvious that it's not cultural space to me, this Daniel. And it's like from 1993, probably, right? And until now, and I was wondering, you as a creator or well-known in art world, to what extent do you think that this Biennale is important for this place? And did this Biennale from then until now change anything in culture or people's daily life or anything like this? I'm obvious.
Yeah, it's a very clear question, and I appreciate it a lot. Thank you. One for Uta. Last chance for other questions. Okay, one more. Yeah, thank you.
I just want to come back. You talked about AC Park, and actually, when it happened, it was quite a conflict with the Biennale. There were open letters, etc. You mentioned now the Congo, people might not appreciate what is done, what Renzo does. So I also want to throw in again the potential of antagonism and confrontation is something very healthy. Collectiveness.
Was that a question? I just didn't believe in antagonism. More an ideology of antagonism. Good. Last question, I think.
And I'm not sure if it's a question or more just an observation that I've been thinking through since this morning. And it's a question around form and around forms that are produced, not necessarily in waste, but forms that are produced out of real urgencies and out of real specific situations, and how those forms are sort of tunneled into a logic of Western contemporary art, in a way that is palatable to a Western form of reception. That's just, I don't know if that's a question, but something that I've been thinking about that I've been quite concerned about.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to come back to the panel and to close the session. I mean, just to go through some of the questions, there were some quite specific ones directed to Renzo that I would like perhaps to conclude with. We talked a little bit about the question of disobedience came up and also teamwork.
And I wonder, given that Gezi was a moment of disobedience, I think, and that teamwork was also part of maybe the consequence, whether you could talk about whether those concepts were interesting to you or how you respond to those things.
It's a little bit complicated, but if we start with the teamwork, when you try to organize the life in an occupation moment or uprising moment, people take responsibility. Like, nobody is making the teams. Somebody comes in and says, like, the toilet needs to be clean, and you say, like, why don't you do it? And people start doing it. Or some group of women came to me and said, like, there's some abuse going on. I said, why don't you phone, like, abuse teams, you know, like, watching for the abuse. So when you're creating a life from zero, you need shelter, food, blah, blah, and everybody has to be part of it. So in that moment, there's no important job or unimportant job. There's no good job or bad job. Everybody leaves their like, prior life behind and just dissolves in the body and the soul of the resistance. You know, there's no I, there's no ego, there's only me. So I cannot explain it in a teamwork word that we usually use in Vedic life. It's another theory. Another way of sharing the experience and sharing the work. And if you talk about difficulty, because you asked about it, I think that was a strategy that we used really good in Turkish context, because not only football, but other stuff. Because what we were trying to do is, first of all, there should be three points, like tripods. Defend the commons, create new commons, and create participants. So to make people participate in something, you have to be attractive, you have to give something like you can help their lives. So Football League was an example for it. And it's a league mixed league. I mean, women and men play together, there's no gender division. There's a team called Deep Dog, like LGBT team. So as happens in normal football matches, they come with banners reacting on that league's actuality, something like that. But the most important thing is, like, in a city like Istanbul or in a country like Turkey, what happens is, like, you are suffocated by this overwhelming politics, so you need some joy. Joy is important to create a political ground. So we are sort of searching for this joy in different things. And football was one example. City gardens are really good for people. Now we are trying to make a place called a place on earth, which is a solidarity space for freelance workers where they can come together and they don't isolate themselves inside their houses, working in pajamas, working in underwear, you know? We are trying to give a reason to people to come out from their houses and meet with each other and chit-chat during a coffee break. So, yeah, like, when you're having a crisis, I think it's important to get prepared and keep the joy. Keep the joy of doing small things, like not only the big politics or world politics or the bombings, but also, like, meeting with people like you and trying to be a community. And there was a third something?
Disobedience.
Well, disobedience. I think I'll pass it because, like, it's totally a different story for me. Disobedience should be discussed starting from the Kurdish movement, but for Turkey, and we don't have time for that. Maybe when we see each other in the group.
I think also the throwback to the epistemic disobedience, which is disobedience to the rule of knowledge or to the code of knowledge. I think that also is very different also from the disobedience to the master Erdogan, who is certainly an existing master, if anybody is in Europe at the moment. I wonder if I can come to Lucy, and there were two issues really. One is, to what extent is there a cultural need in Sharjah for the Biennale? And has there been since 1993 any observable change in that cultural need or in those people? A difficult question to understand. And maybe that's, I think that summarizes also the question of access a little bit, to what extent is the city imposing this Biennale, or not the city, but the ruling family imposing the Biennale, and to what extent is there a cultural need for it? What is the relationship there?
Oh. I don't know, you would have to start with the question of whether art is necessary. No. Yeah, you really think you have to start with that question, whether you deem it necessary, and also whether you deem art or cultural practice as something that has to be definable by deliverables. And I don't believe in these definitions of art or cultural practice. I think that there is, Sharjah's biennial has an impact beyond the so-called local community to a broader so-called regional community in terms of art production for sure, in terms of the access to visual art exhibitions and programs, film screenings, so on and so forth. There's also, and I neglected to talk about this, the biennial also had a series of talks and film screenings based in documentary films. And there is a free public cinema that people can kind of walk into with no visual entrance to it. So there were, you know, there is a lot of accidental encounter with the biennial. And the biennial is free, so you can go into these spaces if you get to this part of the city. At the same time, there have been artists in the Emirates for a long time. The Sheikha was the curator of the UAE Pavilion this year at the Venice Biennale, and she presented, I think, upwards of 15 artists who have been showing since the 1960s, late 60s, but together formed a kind of community of artists, very active in the 1980s and 90s, from Sharjah and Dubai, Abu Dhabi, and other Emirates, Ras Al Khaimah. We did a program with several of these artists to talk about the history of cultural production in the UAE.
According to those
artists, the impact of the Sharjah Art Foundation in general has been very positive and has measurable effect to the ways in which artists practice in the UAE. In terms of the idea of play, I just wanted to say quickly that public space and, you know, if art organizations are also kind of public space or public institutions, I think it's very important to open those doors, you know, to explain to people that they're not only that they're allowed to come in, but how to enter somehow. And so, you know, with the case of the across the chalk line, which is the Gary Simmons cricket field, that was really inspired by incredible work that was done by Superflex in the past Sharjah Biennial, which was a version of their Superkielen park, their public park that they did in Denmark. They did a smaller version in this unused parking island in the center of Bank Street, which is a former important commercial street. It was so successful, I watched it many nights, I watched all the kids and all the, you know, the couples that aren't allowed to meet anywhere, meet there, the workers sit down and have their dinner together at the tables, and I was really inspired by what it meant to use the biennial to designate some public space. And so that's actually completely where it came from. When I saw that, when I thought about that, I said we should contact Gary Simmons, and then I bumped into him on the street and said I have this space, because we were originally going to do it right there in that exact same space, but we later lost access to it. And based on a project that Gary and I had conceived in 1997, which was a basketball court that we would make out of recycled materials in Minneapolis, Minnesota, that we both chickened out of doing because we how difficult and expensive it would be. So, you know, 20 years later, we made this field. The text around the outer boundary is the text by C.L.R. James from Beyond the Boundary that says, what do they know of cricket? Who only cricket know? And it says it in English, Malayalam, Urdu, and Arabic.
and that's where the title is called Crash Chakra.
And I'd like to finalize this session, at least, of the symposium with Renzo. There were a couple of practical questions, and I wonder if you could maybe see afterwards, because I think that could be a fruitful discussion, but I think there's not necessarily going to that so much. I wonder if you could respond to our Congolese friend about what is the nature of the relationship with the Congolese as a nation or a state.
I think you probably, when you looked up things, you probably think you found, or at least most of it, related to this film that you mentioned. At the end, it's just going to be a film. I did indeed make a film, and it's placed here. And even in the film, I say that the film, somebody asked me, will this film be shown here in Congo? There's a particular scene in the film in which somebody asks me, will this film be shown here? And I tell them, no. It will only be shown in Europe. So you're right. But why did I tell him that? Because that is the status quo. The status quo of both critical art production and also most forms of journalism is that Congo is a zone where you can go pick up things and you will put it somewhere else and create added value with it. This is the status quo, and I try to make a portrait of that status quo. Not because I endorsed it, but because that is the status quo. The same thing when I showed you the little film of the gentleman working on the plantation. I tried to, maybe my example was not delivered quite right, but what I tried to bring across is that however much I would film, show the little clip of him in which you see his life, indeed, in all kinds of art institutions, with all kinds of politically engaged critical art practitioners, it's not ever going to change his way of living and the salary he receives if we allow these very same gatherings and institutions in which we perform that critique to be sponsored by, for example, Unilever, or by the Cocoa Board, and do not stand up against them in one way or the other. So your analysis is completely right. However, I must say this, the film that is here was shown in Congo many times. So I lied in the film, in a way. It was shown many times in Congo, including on television in Kinshasa, but of course, on the plantation, nobody has an electricity, so they don't watch it. Just, I went around, and as much as I could, I tried to, give back what has been the reception of that film. And the main thing I tried to do was make sure that such a center of reception, which would be a biennial or an art school or this or that, can be implanted or created or emerge out of the plantation. So I think your analysis is really right. It means too little, if anything at all. And that's why I decided I can't meaningfully critique labor conditions in Congo in a film if it only changes perspective and accumulates capital in all kinds of ways in the place where this film is shown, which most of the time is not Congo. And that's why I, at this point, try to put all my energy in making sure we can have a center for critical engagement in all kinds of ways. People do it in many ways. On the planet. So your analysis is right, and this is what I try to, how I try to deal with it. As for Unilever, well, they did not sponsor us. I did ask them at some point. I thought they created the situation, so I should thank them for it. Somehow, they're a co-author of the whole institute, whether they like it or not. They built the whole situation, they built the plantation, they pay the way, or they don't pay them. They sponsored Kino Segal in Tate Modern. So the entire thing that I try to make a little dent in is created by them. So they're the co-author of this entire piece. So I should thank them for it. That's why I raised that flag.
And on that flag-raising moment, I'd like to end the conversation. Thank you very, very much. Thanks for all the questions. I'm sorry that we were rushed at the end. We are now running about 3/4 of an hour late, so we'll continue 3/4 of an hour late by having a 30-minute break and then coming back just before 5 o'clock. Thank you very, very much.